Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
Silence, the roaring lion. looking into the mirror, knew I wasn't who I wanted to be. I was living life the way that I wanted, but my eyes reminded me I'm not free. Believe the lies, so everything that I know says I gotta go, tired of going solo. But I'm never gonna go there again. This is what it is, this is who I am, this is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to grow. I'm not the one with two scarred hands, giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again. I see you walking like you're living in fear, having trouble even looking at me. Wishing they would give you more than words, sick of people telling how it should be. What you download, where'd you get your info? You saw the hype show, now you're in the endo. Gonna tell you what I believe. Oh, this is what it is, this is who I am, this is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to grow. I met the one with two scarred hands, giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again.
Also, welcome to those who are online gathering with us. I hope you guys have been enjoying the weather this weekend. Man, it is beautiful outside, and you know, I told the last service, you know, this weather kind of makes me miss the drive-in services a little bit. You know, I just kind of want to be outside right now, and so maybe sometime we'll have to. We've got a nice, big, beautiful yard. We could do a really cool work there. But not this Sunday. glad you're here. I just have a couple of announcements for you before we get to our worship time for this morning. CIY Superstart, they leave this next weekend, and so they're heading up to South Dakota, and Brenda's got a number of students, just under 20, going on this trip, and they're excited to go and to be able to worship God and learn some new things and also just have tons of fun. And so what we're doing, back on the table there, just outside of the sanctuary, there are some cards and a little bracelet, and this is just a way to pray for students. It's just a reminder to pray for students. So the card has the name of a student, and then just some different ways that you can be praying for them while they're on this trip. The bracelet, just it's just a little reminder to say, hey, I need to be praying for a student this week while they're on this trip. And so if you want to grab one of those, feel free to do that on your way out of service this morning. You can be praying for them throughout the week as they prep for this trip and then also head out on it. We just would really love to just pray over that and make sure that this trip is blanketed in prayer. Another announcement that I have is coming up later this month on March 20th, our Encounter is having a giant laser tag event. It's going to be tons of fun. Junior high, 3 to 6. High school, 5 to 8. We've got the laser guns coming in, inflatable bunkers. I bought some laser show stuff or whatever. That's going to be a lot of fun. And we're also going to provide food, which is, I know, is one of the best ways to get students to come to an event. Yes, Josh. Maybe we'll have a midnight round for adults. but no, it's going to be tons of fun. So if you know a junior high or high schooler that would enjoy this event, invite them to come. It's going to be a blast. For those of you who are in here who are junior high and high schoolers, you better be inviting your friends. I'm looking at the students that I know. Hi, Jonah. So we have some really fun things going on. And so, this again, if this is your first time with us, there should be a Connect card in the chair in front of you. If you want to grab and fill that out, that's just a quick way for us to get some quick information about you so we can keep in touch and just we don't want to lose you in the weeds and stuff. We know life gets busy, and we want to make sure that we're reaching out to anybody who comes and participates with us on Sundays. And so if you want, you can fill that out and just give it to me or Josh after service. We would just love to connect with you. But with that being said, let me go to God in prayer as we begin our worship this morning. Dear God, we thank you so much for this morning, that this beautiful day that we get to gather here and worship you and praise you, God, to give the being that deserves worship and praise the most his due. And so open up our hearts to that so that we can sing out loud and sing proud to you, God. And just let this be a time of great fellowship and a time where we can grow in our relationship with you and with those around us, and that we as a body can come closer as a family. But God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Welcome. My name is Matt. I'm one of the interim worship leaders here at Whiting Christian Church. We are so glad that you are here to join us this morning. For those of you who are watching online, welcome. Let's do some standing this morning. Let's do some singing.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, yeah, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered. that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Will you guys take a quick minute and say hello? You haven't seen in a while. We'll be right with you in a few minutes.
We're going to continue worship this morning.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love. His love for me, whom the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. A slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
I'm chosen.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. One more time. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Whom the sun sets free, oh, is free. Child of God. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Lift this up with me.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. One more time. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am.
Father God, we are chosen, not forsaken. You are who you say we are. And we honor you this morning through our words and our praise and our worship. Lord, I ask that you would please bless Josh and his words this morning. Lord, even sometimes when we confuse our words, Lord, your words come true. They come forward and we can still listen and apply your lessons to our lives. Lord, would you meet us in this place this morning? Lord, we love you. In your son's name, amen. You guys may be seated.
You know, I thought about it, Josh, and I will welcome any adult to laser tag as long as they're willing to sign a commitment to serve at Encounter for a year. Now, so I do, I hope you guys have been enjoying the weather recently. With the women's conference going on, Magnolia and I were hanging out yesterday, and we were able to enjoy the weather. Yesterday morning, we went down to the park in Ottawa and played some disc golf. And I say we because Magnolia doesn't really have a choice. It's, hey, Dad's going here. You get to go with him. And so, someday she might have more of a choice, but not right now. But we had fun. She does enjoy disc golf. She likes to throw the discs and stuff. But so we did that. And then in the afternoon, we went here in the park here in town and played on the playground. And we went back home and played in the yard with the dogs. And we spent a lot of time outside just enjoying the weather. And it was a good day. Now, I seriously doubt that all the bad weather is behind us. We live in Iowa. That's just not how it works. And so, I do love this glimpse of spring, though. This glimpse of spring with the trees budding and the geese coming back up north. The snow, it's funny, just a couple weeks ago we got 14 inches of snow and now it's pretty much all gone. And you can be outside for more than 15 minutes without having to worry about frostbite. I enjoy those things. So, last night I had to go outside to get something, and I paused, and it was a clear night, and so you could see all the stars, and it wasn't cold outside, so I wasn't hurrying to get back inside, so I paused, and I was able to look up at the stars for what felt like the first time in a while, And I just love looking at the beauty of the things that God has created. And it made me think of a passage of Scripture. And it's one of my favorites, and it's Psalm 8. Now, Psalm 8, just to explain something, has an important literary structure in it that tells us, hey, here's where the important part is. And it's called a chiasm. I don't really need to go into that. But in college, when we were learning about these, they basically explained them like a sandwich. Think of a sandwich, right? You got the two buns, right? And so it begins and ends in the same thing. And so in Psalm 8, it begins and ends with the same line. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And so it begins with that and it ends with that phrase. And what we do when we see that, when we see this structure, what our professors taught us was you need to ask a certain question, and it's where's the meat? Right? Because if you think about a sandwich, the important part's in the middle. Bread is good, but the meat is where I come. That's why I'm eating a sandwich, is for the meat. And so if we look at Psalm 8, here in the middle, there's these two lines, and this is the meat of the psalm. This is what it says. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. You have made them a little lower than angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You see, the psalmist before these two lines and after these two lines has been talking about the beautiful creation that God has made. The stars in the heavens, the animals that run along this earth, pretty much anything that we could look out and enjoy on a beautiful day is the work of our Father. And he's saying, hey, look at all this. Look at the amazing things that God has created. Yet, do you know what? What does he pay special attention to us, to mankind? What is mankind that you are mindful of them? In an entire universe to take care of, in an entire universe that God is helping spin on, he cares for us. And what I think is amazing about this and what we know about our God is it's not just, yes, it says mankind, but it's more than just as us as a whole. God cares about us as individuals. That with a universe to take care of, God cares for Jed. He cares for Jonah. He cares for all of us. And that's amazing to me. And so, you know, as I look up at the stars last night, I couldn't help think about this passage of, in this great expanse of everything going on in our universe, God cares for me. And so as you know, as we go out and we have this nice weather, this glimpse of spring before Iowa brings us back to reality, I can't help but think of, you know, the important ways that God is taking care of us. And the most important way is through the death of his son. That Jesus would come to this earth, love personified, would come to this earth to take care of us. Again, yes, as a whole, but also as individuals. That he didn't just die for all of us, but he died for me because I make mistakes. That I have my own things that I have distanced myself from God in my life. That we all have those things in our life. And God has come into our life and he has said, hey, I'm going to take care of that for you because I love you. Because he loves us as an individual with all the different things in creation going on. He takes care of us. Would you pray with me? Dear God, I just want to repeat what the psalmist said here in Psalms 8. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? God, we on a daily basis are failing you. We make mistakes. We do things that are outside of your desires for us. And with an entire universe to take care of, you love us still. That you don't give up on us. And it's not only this, but you have given us a place in creation that we are the only ones made in your image. God, you love us so well, and we thank you for that. We thank you for your Son who came into this world to save us. That the mistakes that I make can be forgiven. That I don't have to bear that burden. That I can lay it at the foot of the cross and know that Jesus has taken it for me. God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. As you came in this morning, you should have gotten a little cup that has a wafer and some juice, and the wafer represents Jesus' body that was broken on the cross, and the juice represents his blood. And so now is the time where you can pull those out. We will take this meal together as this song plays. So as we come to this time of offering, you know, something with this time of COVID is that it hasn't been easy on students. Something that's incredibly important for students' development is structure. And something we've lacked during COVID is a good set of structure. You know, with everything changing, school changing, sports changing, a lot of things are put online. You know, that can take its toll on students, and we've seen that across our country during this time. And so what we love about what we're able to do here at our church is have things like our trip to Superstart or the laser tag event, something where students can get out of the house and they can go do something and be together in person with friends and have that connection again. That it's just so vitally important, and during this time that's made possible through your giving, that we are able to do these things. It's through your giving, and so we thank you for that. That your continued generosity, it really is impacting lives, and not just here in our church, but in our community. And so we thank you for that. And if you would like to give this morning, there is the box there in the back. You can give online on our website. But, you know, if you haven't been able to tell yet, we want to bring something to you every week of new ways that your giving is impacting the church. And we do that not to be like, hey, you should give more or whatever, but just to show you that it is making a difference, that it is making a difference in the lives of people, and it's growing the kingdom of God, and that's amazing, and we thank you again for that. So if you would, I'll pray for our offering, and I'll invite Josh up to share the message with us this morning. Dear God, we thank you for the way that you bless this church, that even in times of uncertainty, we can gather together and have these fun events like Superstar or the laser tag, and just love on students well, and to give them an opportunity to get out of the house and to be with friends and have that personal connection again. We thank you that during this time, we've just been able to continue on as a church and to love those around us. And we just pray that you continue to help us do that, to further your kingdom, God. And that's what we're talking about this morning, is kingdom. And so I just want to pray for Josh as he shares the message with us this morning, that these will be your words that you are speaking through him, that come from your word in the Bible, and that it's something that we can learn from and grow from and move on and take it into our lives and into the people's around us lives and show them what it is to have a relationship with you, God. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Thanks, Jen. Yep. Hey, all cards on the table. If y'all are like even a little bit wanting to help out with an encounter, I've seen some of the stuff that he's setting up for laser tag. Worth it. All right. If it means signing up to help lead encounter and help mentor students for an entire year, that's awesome by itself. Plus, you get to play laser tag, which is looking amazing. Yeah. Woo. Hey, real quick, Matt, how many bracelets are still back there by the door?
I got five.
All right, there's five bracelets back there. Make sure you grab those. What those are is that's a way to remind you to pray for the students and the leaders that are on our Superstar trip. I have mine, as you can see. Mine's a little small for my wrist. So assess, adapt, overcome. It's now a ring. But I'm going to be praying for the students here over the next couple days and just praying for those students that are going to be going on that trip and praying for the leaders. Every time I go back to see that ring, it reminds me that I'm going to be praying for them. So I encourage you to do that too. We have a couple left, so make sure you grab those at the end of the service here. Well, hey, folks, we're in this series we're calling The Big Picture. And the reason we're calling it this is because we believe that the Bible is a long, complex story about God and his people. And it ultimately flows towards Jesus. Jesus is the target of the Bible. Everything points to Jesus. And so we've been taking this time to go through the major events in Scripture and talk about how they point to Jesus. Because right now, we're in this season of expectation towards Easter. Depending on what tradition you grew up in, you may have called it Lent growing up. We're in the season that's there to prepare us as God's people to experience Easter, which is coming up in just a few weeks. So we're doing that by walking through Scripture and looking at the big events in the biblical history and how they point to Jesus. We started by talking about Adam and Eve, and we talked about how the failure of Adam and Eve, while it comes to kind of set the tone for a lot of human interaction, it doesn't ultimately have the final say. And in fact, God says in that promise that human failure will not be the defining moment of humanity. And in fact, he's sending someone in the far future who's going to crush deception, crush the serpent's head, and how evil will not prevail. And then last week we talked about Abraham and the promises of Abraham and the promise that God made to Abraham and how God's promises are secure. While they don't necessarily happen in our time frame, they're as secure as the ground you're walking in. And we talked about how God had promised Abraham that through him, even though he was in his 90s, he was going to have a child that would end up being the father of a nation. And then that nation would be so blessed that it would bless the rest of the world. And so we talked about how God's promises are absolutely secure because he made that happen through Jesus. Well, today we're going to kind of do some more history work. We're going to skip ahead in history, but to kind of fill in some of the gaps here. After Abraham, eventually the Hebrews found themselves slaves in Egypt. And for 400 years, they struggled under the oppression of their Egyptian rulers, slaving away, being mistreated. And they called out to God for deliverance, and God delivered them from Egypt. He sent Moses, and here's when everybody remembers the old movie with Charlton Heston, you know, "Let my people go." Moses actually had a stutter, so It probably didn't sound like Charlton Heston, but in any case, that's a great image. So yeah, that right there, that event happens, and the people of God leave Egypt, and they get the Ten Commandments, and then they go into the wilderness, and they wander for 40 years because of their sin, and eventually they come into the Promised Land. And this is when you get the story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho, a personal favorite of mine. So they step into the Promised Land, and over the generations, they settle there. But the people of God look very different than the other nations around them, because they're not structured the same way. They don't have a traditional king, per se. Their government kind of looks a little different. They are one people. They identify as one people. They're not like just little city-states. They are one people. But they don't have the same political structure that all of their neighbors do. They didn't have a king. Well, it's not entirely true. Because to the people of God at the time, they actually did have a king. The king was God. And that's not just a church phrase. That's not just like, King God, of course God's our king. No, like the people of the Hebrews in the Promised Land, they saw God as their literal king. He was the political ruler of their country. And his will was then lived out by three offices that they had in different times throughout their history. And those offices were the offices of priest. A priest's job is to maintain the practices of worship, maintain the temple, and just kind of take care of the flock and make sure that the practice and the teaching of the law is good. You had the role of prophet. A prophet's role is to speak the word of God and to communicate what God's will is for the people. And then you had occasionally judges. And what judges would be is they would be specific people called to lead in a specific situation. And so a judge would be raised up out of the crowd to lead Israel and lead the people of God out of a specific crisis. And so, by the way, if you ever have, if you're a nerd like me and love reading biblical history, spending some time reading about priests, prophets, and judges is an awesome read. But don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with that today, because that'll take, I could talk about that for like 3 hours. But in any case, take a look at it. It's super interesting. But, so this is the structure that Israel had. This is how they lived for hundreds of years. God was king, and God's will was executed in the nation through priests, through prophets, and occasionally judges. And that's where we catch up to the kingdom at this point. This is where we meet an interesting dude named Samuel. And Samuel is a cool guy. Samuel, he's living right about the end of this period of time. The people have become a little restless with their situation. They've now lived for quite a number of generations in this kind of weird political structure. But Samuel had an interesting authority role. Samuel was both high priest and also a prophet. So he was both in charge of maintaining the temple, maintaining the worship procedures and teaching the law, but he was also a prophet. He was given a word from God and whose job it was to communicate what God's word was to the people. He also occasionally would serve as a judge, leading people of Israel through specific circumstances. So Samuel was this really interesting character in biblical history who was all three of those roles combined: priest, prophet, and judge. But the people were getting restless. They saw their neighbors, they saw these nations around them, and they saw how they had this structure of kings. And that's what they knew. They knew how they lived, and they wondered why they were different. And over the generations, they started to get even more restless with this setup. And that's where we're going to catch up. We're in the book of 1 Samuel. We're going to be in chapter 8, starting in verse 4. So the elders of Israel gathered together, and they came to Samuel at Ramah. And they said to him, "You are old." That's a great opener. "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways." Now, Samuel had two sons, and he was hoping that they could inherit his position, at least in some way. But they weren't really following God, at least not to the same level that he was. So the people are saying, "And your sons do not follow your way. Now appoint us a king to lead. We want to look like all the other nations, as such all the other nations have. So give us a king. We're tired of not having a king. Give us a king. We want a king. Verse 6. But when they said, give us a king to lead us, this displeased Samuel. Because remember, God is king. They already have a king. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, listen to all the people are saying to you. It is not you that they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. As they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are doing to you. Now, real quick, a little bit of history. Throughout this entire time, the people of God have gone through this cycle of following God, getting complacent with God, falling away from God, following other gods, getting into trouble, and then God saves them. Kind of this constant cycle in history. So God's kind of bringing that up. It's like, yeah, this is nothing new. They do this all the time. Verse 9, now listen to them, as in give them a king. But warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights. In other words, Samuel's bothered because he's like, you know, you don't want a king because God is our king. And what you're doing is you're saying we don't want God as our king. And so he goes to God and he's like, I don't know what to do. And God's like, they asked for a king, give them a king. But warn them. Make sure they understand what they're doing. So Samuel goes on to warn the people. He tells them that having a king is not what's best for the people, at least not how they see it. The people persist, though. They're like, no, look at all these other nations. They have kings. They're doing great. We want to look like them. Give us a king. So Samuel gives in. He appoints a king. And Samuel crowns Israel's first king, a guy named Saul. Now, a little bit about Saul. We're going to blast through some history here. A little bit about Saul. Saul is a great, great guy. He's a great general. He's a great warrior. He's just this amazing, charismatic leader. People flock to him. He is this awesome power on the battlefield, in crowds. People love Saul. He's actually a really good king at first. But over time, Saul begins to let the power in this kingship go to his head. He starts second-guessing God. God will give him commands, and he'll be like, maybe we'll change this a little bit. I don't know if that's what's best for our country. At one point, God sends him into a city and gives him very specific instructions on how to conquer the city, and he kind of makes his own decisions. So over time, this unwillingness to fully submit to God starts to manifest in other ways, and this power goes to Saul's head, and he starts to fall out of favor with God. And in this time, he also becomes super jealous of a man in his court, amazing servant, artist, general, soldier in his court, a young man named David. And David then becomes the target of all of Saul's dark feelings. He begins to hate David. He conspires to kill David, murder him. As you're thinking, as a king, he's allowed to do that. But no, he's a king with the authority that God gave him. So no, he's not really allowed to murder someone. Well, eventually he falls out of favor with God because of this selfish streak. And actually, David then becomes king. And this is the same David you know. David is the one, he's famous in the land. He's the one who, as a child, defeated Goliath, the biggest, strongest, most powerful warrior that the Philistines could muster. And as a child, David took him out with a sling. David is a man described as a man after God's own heart. His faith is so secure. He has so much boldness and love for God. He follows God with everything he has, and he will risk everything for the glory of Yahweh. The people love David. And actually, David's a really, really good king. He ushers in this entire golden age of the kingdom of Israel where they just flourish. Their territory expands. They have all this power. They have all this success and wealth. And there are people defined by their love of Yahweh. And so their worship of God, again, is elevated. And they're in this golden age of Israel. But eventually, David falters. David has a secret affair with a woman named Bathsheba, a wife of one of his soldiers, Uriah the Hittite. When she becomes pregnant, he tries to hide the affair and set up a situation where it looks like Uriah is the father. And when that doesn't work, David conspires to have Uriah killed. So we're in 2 Samuel now, chapter 11, verse 14. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab, his general, and sent it with Uriah. So Uriah is carrying this letter. And in it he wrote, "Put Uriah out in the front where the fighting is fiercest. Then withdraw from him so that he will be struck down and die." So while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah at the place where he knew the strongest defenders were. And when the men from the city came out and fought against Joab, some of the men in David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite died. So David killed Uriah. He didn't swing the sword, but he gave the order that set him up in a very specific situation in order to die in battle. And what's more is he had Uriah carry the orders himself, which is just a whole other level of cold. So these sins eventually come back to haunt David. He gets called out on the sins, and these lead to destruction in David's household and arguably sets the pace for many kings to come. And you know, eventually David and Bathsheba's son that they have from this affair, David and Bathsheba's son dies directly because of this sin. And David goes into this season of deep grief, which actually, historians argue that this period of deep grief actually helps spawn kind of the season of uncertainty that begins to define some of the future cultural aspects of the kingdom of Israel. After David died, his son Solomon eventually took the throne. Solomon, again, he was a great king. People loved him. He was awesome, all right? People flocked to him. He was rich beyond your wildest dreams. He finished the temple of God, the big temple of God. Solomon built it. He finished it. It was a huge thing. But again, in a cycle that's becoming very predictable, Solomon falls to sin. And over time, power goes to his head, the wealth goes to his head, he ends up with hundreds of wives, he ends up faltering in his worship of Yahweh and allowing the worship of multiple gods, and even participating himself in idolatry in several ways. And king after king after king after king go through this entire history of the people of God, falter like this. They start out good, never quite as good as David, and they fail. In fact, after Solomon, there's a big civil war. The kingdom splits in two, arguing over who's going to be in power. And then from there, just generation after generation after generation, the corruption in the kings get worse and worse and worse and worse. But the people still remembered that short period of time in the beginning of David's reign when they were in this amazing golden age and they worshiped Yahweh and they had all this wealth and success. And so they looked at that time period as this is what we're supposed to be. But they look outside and they're watching their culture and their country and their people slowly fall apart. That begs the question to me, where do you put your faith? Because we love kings, right? We love kings. We don't really call them kings anymore. It's not really cool to call them kings. We call them other names. We call them names like athletes, celebrities, politicians, influencers. We love our kings. We line up to follow them. We form political parties or fandoms or tailgate with teams. And none of that's necessarily bad. It's just we really like our kings. We read about and we watch their battles. Now, they're not like sword and shield in a field. Instead, they're usually in the form of a football game or a debate or a BuzzFeed article about a recent breakup. But we follow their battles. As human beings, we love kings. We love heroes. Because a hero, someone like that, a king, a hero, a celebrity, someone like that tells us that even when the world doesn't make sense, success is still possible, right? We love that. Because when they win, it shows us we can win. If that guy can shoot a basket from that far away, man, that means it's possible. That's awesome. And it is awesome. But when do we make our kings? When do we put our faith in kings? When do we move our honoring of celebrity, our enjoyment of success? When does that become worship? When does that become we place our faith and identity in kings? Because people, human beings, they're far from perfect. And our kings will almost always fail at some point, right? Underneath the wealth, underneath the glory, underneath the public relations team and the press conferences, underneath all of that, our kings are still human. They have the same uncertainties, the same selfish ambitions, and the same desires for achievement as we do. They have the same flaws that we do. That means that our kings are just as susceptible to failure as we are. And sure enough, our media is full of stories of fallen kings. You can't scroll through Facebook for more than 10 seconds or walk by the magazine aisle in the grocery store without seeing the exploits of our fallen kings, arrests, addiction. Affairs, corruption. Do not place your faith in earthly kings. Samuel warned us about it way back when. Don't place your faith in a human king. Celebrate by all means. I'm sorry, when you take a half-court shot, that's crazy. We clap. We celebrate. We honor you for that. If you're leading a country, yeah, you need the support of the people. I get it. We're going to honor you with that. Awesome. But I'm not going to put my faith in a person. I'm not going to let my identity be decided by a human being. Because people are just as flawed as I am. I'm not going to rest my identity in that because, folks, you're worth more than that. You're worth so much more than having your identity rest on Kanye's latest album or on a political party winning power. You're worth more than that. Early in David's reign, God made him a promise. He made him a promise in 2 Samuel, verse 7. He said, "The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you." And here we are in verse 12. "When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you." All right, that makes sense. Solomon came. "Your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom." All right, still makes sense. Verse 13. "He is the one who will build a house for my name." Solomon finished the temple. Okay, that makes sense. "And I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." Stop. That didn't happen with Solomon. So this isn't talking about Solomon. Because we learned with Abraham that when God issues a promise, those promises are as secure as the ground beneath us. It may not happen in the time frame that we expected to, but they are absolutely secure. And here God is saying that the reign of David's offspring will be forever. So what's he talking about? This promise is then echoed generations later by the prophet Isaiah. So here we are, Samuel's at the beginning of this time period. Isaiah's at the very end of this time period. Israel had fallen into chaos and corruption, and Israel is about to be conquered. The people are seeing the enemy at the gates. They're about to be destroyed. And Isaiah has this word to give to the people. Isaiah 11 says, a shoot will come out of the stump of Jesse. Jesse is David's father. So he's saying right here is that a shoot, offspring of David's line. And his roots, and from his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but his righteousness will judge the needy. With justice, he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth and with the breath of his lips. He will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt and faithfulness the sash around his waist. Pause. Remember, he is saying this to a people who are literally about to see their country fall. Verse 6, the wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and the little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, and the young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den. And the young child will put his hand into the viper's nest. Peace and no fear. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And then verse 10, in that day, the root of Jesse, David's offspring, will stand as a banner for the peoples, the nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. So in other words, Isaiah is telling the people as they're watching their country fall, Isaiah is saying, don't worry. A king is coming, but not a king like you're used to seeing, not a human king, not a king who's going to fail, a king who is actually worthy of the title, a king who is righteous beyond measure, a king is wise beyond measure, and that king will establish a kingdom like you've never seen. A kingdom defined by peace and blessing for all nations. A kingdom defined by Jesus, by God, by his value. Now we're on this side of history. We know he's talking about Jesus. Jesus, being fully God and fully human, stepped into this world and he experienced all the temptations that we felt. He experienced all the temptations that we could possibly have, yet he remained innocent, remained pure, pure and sinless, unblemished lamb. And he died. He went to that cross for us. And he conquered death in the process. Jesus is our perfect king. And Jesus loves you so much that he endured the cross for you so that you don't have to pay that same payment for your sin. So where do you put your faith? Do you put your faith in human kings, in celebrities, in athletes, and influencers, or do you put your faith in the one king who is worthy of that title? Because when that king came, when Jesus stepped foot into our world, he announced a new kingdom defined by how Isaiah defined it, a kingdom defined by love, by peace, by a lack of fear. A kingdom where we live in the purpose that we were given. As human beings created in the very image of God. A kingdom like nothing else that would reign forever. And not built on human ambition or human power, but instead built by love, built by peace, and defined by grace. You are a part of that kingdom. Jesus began building that kingdom 2,000 years ago. Arguably, God began building that kingdom with Adam and Eve. But Jesus announced the ushering in of that kingdom 2,000 years ago, and it's been slowly expanding its borders ever since. And today, you sit here. You sit here as someone who is charged with building this kingdom. Because God is building this kingdom here in Whiting. He's building this kingdom in Ottawa. He's building this kingdom in Iowa. He's building this kingdom in the world. You are a member of this kingdom. You are someone who has been claimed by God. You are a child of God. God loves you beyond measure. No matter where you've been, no matter what your past is, God adores you. You have citizenship in this kingdom. Which means we have a responsibility to build this kingdom. God is building this kingdom here, now, today, and he's building it through you in your neighborhoods, in your workplace, in your school, on your street. He's doing it now. We build this kingdom by having the eyes to see our neighbors and being able to respond to their needs, physical, emotional, spiritual needs. Really see them. Not as categories or as an address or as a political affiliation or as that guy with weird hair, but see them as God's creation. And then we have to have the boldness to live on mission, the boldness to be able to be known as a light bearer of King Jesus. Jesus is our king. He's the only king that matters. And he is building that kingdom right now, today, with you. Let's pray. Dear Father God, dear God, I'm not going to put my faith in earthly kings. And you know what? God, I pray that no one puts their faith in me. I pray that they look to you. You know, I'm a pastor, I'm a mouthpiece, I'm a servant. I'm also just a dude who's flawed like everybody else. I want to be known as someone who points to you. I don't want them to look at me, I want them to look at you. And I want that same truth for all of us. May our lives point to you. May our lives glorify you, King Jesus. And through us, build your kingdom here. Build your kingdom here in Whiting, in Ottawa, in Sloan, in Hornick, in Correctionville, in... I don't know all the names of the towns in the area. I'm sorry. But build your kingdom here. Use us. Use our interactions. Use our friendships with our neighbors. Use our presence in the workplace. Build your kingdom here with us. We're ready. We want to see it. We want to see your kingdom here. Use us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much, Josh. So as you can probably hear the alluding to, we're going to sing our next song. It's called Build Your Kingdom Here. It's made popular by Ren Collective. We have not sung this in a little bit of time. It involves something called a shindig. Has anyone ever heard of a shindig before? A jig or shindiggery? Okay, so it's going to be a little fast-paced, and we'll just see how it goes, and we'll see you on the other side, okay? All right, there's your chorus. All right. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and
church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray. One set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come and invade us now. And we are your church, and we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first, we hunger and we refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive's hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church, and we pray, revive in this earth. Kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Know your mighty hands, win your streets and land. Set your church on fire and win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom. Your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty changing hearts. You made us so much more than this. Awake the kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. And we are your church, and we are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. And set your church on fire. Win this nation in time. Change the streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here. We pray.
Woo! Amen. You guys, it is an absolute honor and pleasure to be able to lead worship with you guys this morning. We will see you next week. Take care. The name of Jesus.